Hello, and welcome to Survey Magazine's webinar series. My name is John Lehman, and I will be your moderator this afternoon. Today, we are presenting a case study on how InterContinental Hotels Group recently used agile market research to get fast and quality consumer feedback to innovate in their e-commerce space. Today's event is brought to you by Survey Magazine and being broadcast by Research Radio. The sponsor for today's webinar is GutCheck. Before we get started, I want to review a few housekeeping items and let you know how you can participate in today's session. Throughout the presentation, we encourage you to interact with our speakers by typing in questions and comments using the questions panel on the right side of your screen. We will be collecting your questions and comments during the presentation and conducting a question and answer period after today's presentation. If you'd like to join the conversation on Twitter or in social media, the hashtag is hashtag survey webinar. The webinar name for today's guest is GutCheckIt. So please make sure you put the last IT in, on the word GutCheck for our sponsor. We'd love to have you connect with us in social media and keep the conversation going beyond today's event. Also, we are recording today's session and we'll make the link to the recording available within the next day or so by sending you an email where you can click on the link to access the on-demand recording of the webinar. You will also be able to access the audio recording of the event at researchradio.org shortly after our presentation today. So let's get right to it. Tom Noggle is a senior manager for IHG's Global Insights Group, where he manages the global research platforms and supports all global sales and marketing functions. He has been in research for over 15 years, serving both vendor side and the client side representation, as well as the academia. Tom is currently working with IHG to optimize communication, product offers, and loyalty program and benefits. But starting us off today is going to be Matt Warta. Matt is the Chief Executive Officer at the global market research firm GutCheck. Over the past 15 years, Matt has been a mainstay in the entrepreneurial community, co-founding two companies and funding dozens of others. Prior to GutCheck, he was a general partner with Village Ventures, growing the firm's investment from over $100 million to nearly $750 million. He also co-founded and led business developments for CyberCrop, which pioneered online trading of agricultural commodities. As a member of Koch Ventures, Matt led several investments that either went public or were acquired. Earlier in his career, he was a senior consultant in Deloitte's financial services practice. Matt is also a diehard Jayhawk fan, having graduated from the University of Kansas with both a BA and an MBA. So, gentlemen, I'd like to welcome you both to today's event. And Matt, the floor is yours. Please continue with your presentation. Thank you again.
Thanks so much, John. I really appreciate that introduction, and thank you, everyone, today for joining us. And participating in our webinar. I also want to thank Tom, who's been great working with us to come up with the content, and really excited to hear him talk today. And as John also mentioned, as we go along in the presentation today, if you have a question, just put it in the chat box, and we'll do our best to get to it at the end of the presentation. So the way we're going to unpack this today is, first of all, we're going to talk about agile market research. If you remember from the introduction, it's about agile market research and how it is working with e-commerce development. In order to talk about it, though, we're first going to talk about agile software development because that's the software methodology for how most e-commerce systems are developed. And actually most software for that matter. So we're going to talk about agile software development. We'll then talk about how agile market research has a very hand glove kind of fit with agile software development. Tom will then take the floor, talk about his experience at IHG. He'll talk about some of the challenges he faces in his role. He'll talk about his process that he uses for the development of his e-commerce system. And he'll not only talk about how Agile plays a part in that development process, but he'll also talk about other methodologies and techniques he uses to come up with a great experience for his customers. And then we'll wrap it up with some Q&A. So with that, let me jump in. Yeah, first of all, as we get started talking about Agile software development, I think it's very important to understand how big of a presence it is in development organizations today. 91% of development organizations today use Agile software development as their primary methodology. And that has come a long way since just 2001. It was really nascent at the time, but has really kind of picked up a lot of steam since 2001 and is really now pervasive. And I think the reason why is very interesting. Before Agile software development, most things were done in a waterfall technique, which is to say that companies would develop products for customers, software products for customers, and spend a lot of time up front understanding user requirements, trying to be super specific about what those requirements were. So that the development teams could go off for extended periods of time, certainly months at a time, and develop the software, and then come back with a deliverable at the end of the day. And what they found, is, especially as the market got much more dynamic over time, is that things would happen during development. We'd learn something new about customers. Alignment challenges internally would cause hiccups in the process. And those changing consumer dynamics and changing internal dynamics caused misses at the end of the development process. So we either had products that were failing in the market or that there was a considerable amount of rework done. The way that Agile solves for that is, first of all, it's very consumer-centric. It's very focused on getting consumers involved in the process early and in a continuous way. So they're really there with you for the entirety of the journey. It's also about really kind of decoupling the process into much smaller components. So instead of having developers go away for extended periods of time, it's really about going away for 2 to 3 weeks at a time and letting consumer feedback play a part at the end of each sprint, so that in that next sprint, you can define what you need to do by that very iterative feedback that you're receiving. And then the results are typically kind of a more optimized deliverable at the end of the day. And this is just kind of a representation of how it works. The number of sprints for any given process are really a function of how large the development initiative is. So this is just kind of a representation of that. And it turns out it works. It works very well. And it really has delivered on the promise of better, faster, and cheaper, which I think in the market research we're certainly all after. So if you look at those that use Agile software development, 80% of them report faster time to market. So there's your fast. 79% see enhanced software quality versus other methodologies. So there's the better part. And finally, 85% report increased team productivity. So teams are more productive, they're more efficient, and spending less to get a better outcome. So I think it's kind of fair to say that Agile software development is not going anywhere given that kind of value proposition. Now let's switch gears and talk about e-commerce a bit. E-commerce isn't going anywhere either. It's a $1.5 trillion industry today, which, you know, most industries that would probably mean it's pretty mature. But the interesting thing is it's still growing rapidly. And there's a few interesting dynamics in terms of why. Certainly tech savvy consumers are a big reason for that. If you look at the millennial group, 40% of the men in that group and 33% of the women in that group would ideally buy everything online. So as that as the millennials gain more and more discretionary income, this will be a powerful trend. Availability of information. 2/3 of in-store shoppers will check prices on their phones or the web before purchasing. There's just an abundance of information out there. There's ratings, there are algorithms recommending what you should be purchasing, and people are leveraging that. And then finally, there's choices. There's unlimited shelf space online. And given the rising need to address the long tail of consumer demand, e-commerce is really kind of a robust way to meet much of that demand. From a figures perspective, that means very rapid growth. So even at $1.5 trillion industry, retail e-commerce still grew by 30% in 2014. During that same time period, in-store sales was flat. So the distribution, most the new growth is coming through online. Interestingly, mature categories like CPG grew even faster than the average at 42%. And it is on its way to becoming a $40 billion channel for CPG in the U.S. By the end of 2018. Even as the most mature country for e-commerce, the U.S. is still growing in double digits, and it should grow in double digits through 2018. I believe this is the first year that the U.S. has been eclipsed by Asia-Pacific in terms of leadership in e-commerce. And then finally, you can see that the growth worldwide is even faster. So with e-commerce not slowing down anytime soon, agile software development is going to be continued to be used to develop great e-commerce systems for customers. So how do we inject that consumer feedback in that early, continuous, and iterative way in the process? Well, we're a little biased, but we're going to argue that agile market research is a great way to do that. A little bit about agile market research. It's a nascent category. It's one that we really created 3 years ago, and many others are now in that market doing some interesting things. But the reason why it's gained so much momentum is, number one, it's fast. Typically, to get deliverables from an agile perspective, you can measure things in days, which obviously is in line with how agile software development is working. It's also quite affordable. There's a lot of use of technology and automation in the process, and this really compresses the cost of providing the consumer feedback you need. So you can really extend your research budgets and use that research throughout the process versus specific points. And these first two, fast and affordable, really make it the ability to iterate very meaningful. So if you think again about those sprints that I outlined during the Agile software development part of this talk, you can use Agile market research for each one of those increments because it's always going to be on time and it's going to be affordable enough where you can use it in a very continuous way. It's also highly adaptable for a lot of these same reasons. And by adaptability, what I mean by that is it can really meet you where you are in the process. And I think Tom's going to have an interesting example of this where he was very thoughtful in terms of his approach, in terms of how he was going to use the consumer in the process, what methodologies that he was going to use. But he also had an unplanned need that came up where he was able to leverage Agile market research. And then it really focuses on the answers. This is not about a 120-page PowerPoint deck. It's really about that specific information that you need to move forward in the next iteration of whatever your process is, whether it's moving forward with an e-commerce process step or a stage gate step in a traditional new product development process. So what's the value of Agile? We do an annual survey on the state of Agile market research here at GutCheck, and our recent poll found that 80% of those that are using Agile market research are finding value and are finding success with Agile market research. And what I mean by that is, in how they explained it in the survey, is that they're getting things on time, they're getting things on budget, and they're receiving the value that they were looking for from the methodology. And when asked what are kind of the top value dimensions of Agile, flexibility came up 55% of the time. Responding to change came up 51% of the time. This is really two sides of the same coin. So it's really that ability to be adaptive in your research process. Accelerate time to market came up 43% of the time, which, again, is consistent are in line with what we saw on the software development side. I think a little bit of the discrepancy in terms of the magnitude of the numbers here are that Agile market research has been around 3 years, and Agile software development is definitely into two decades now. And then again, because of that speed, the affordability, the flexibility, it gives you that ability to iterate multiple times in a research process. And finally, affordability really rounded out the group. So I think your argument here today is that given how e-commerce is going to continue to grow in the future, the underlying software development methodology that is going to be used to develop those e-commerce systems, Agile market research is really going to be a great fit in terms of making a great experience for the customers at the end of the day. With that, I will turn it over to Tom.
Great. Thanks. I appreciate you setting me up like that. So that was an interesting slide. You know, I was just thinking about the slide again as, you know, how are people responding to this top five ways Agile adds value? And, you know, I'm just a market researcher, right? And, you know, when I think about my typical issues I got to deal with, you always think are, oh, time and money. So, but then you look at this chart and it's time and money are third and fifth on the list. And then when I really think about my issues, like, well, you know, it's not just time and money. It's also the 18 people that I've got to try to make happy. And it's also the same old typical way people are doing market research that just is sometimes just boring. And it doesn't get you all the fancy answers you need. And that looks like more like the flexible and responding to change. So I guess when I really put a lot more thought into where my real problems are, it's not really so much as time and money, because you know, that's everybody's problem. It's really these other ways of doing the research that make it add value. So anyway, I wasn't supposed to talk about that, but I was just thinking about it, so I did. I guess a little bit about me. I've done research a long time. I've done research of some kind or another for 15 years, and I'm not trying to sell myself to you. This isn't a job interview. This is really just me saying I know where a lot of you have been and what you struggle with. 8 years in market research specifically. I've been doing all sorts of qualitative and quantitative insights both, and they're going to talk a little bit more later about the mix of qual and quant that they're seeing people do, and I'll add a little bit of that as well. But our primary goal in an insights function, remember, isn't just to produce research. It's not to produce that, what you said, a 150-page deck, which no one's going to go through. And if they are going through it, they have way too much time on their hand. But it's to provide those, you know, those key nuggets of insight that you said, here's what people are saying. Based on this, if I was you, I would do this. So I've done primary, secondary research. And, you know, in the past, I've also been on the analytics side. And then research design as well. You know, here at IHG, we have a lot of different folks, just like a lot of you folks on the line. You deal with a lot of different stakeholders across your organization, and it's the same here at IHG. So the primary folks that I work with over here are going to be, you know, our brand teams and our product teams, and our digital teams, and our mobile teams, and our partnerships teams. So we work across all of sales and marketing here, and it's really interesting being in a unique role. You know, as researchers, if you guys are researchers on the phone, you know that you're in a unique position, and it's really cool sometimes because you get to see how the rest of sales and marketing works, and often sales and marketing teams don't even know what each other are doing, and you're in this unique spot where you can say, I know what all you guys are doing. And that's one of the hugest value adds that we have as researchers. So, you know, overall, that slide is just supposed to be, hey, I understand where you guys are coming from. I've been there. And I'm still going through it today. But, you know, we all got into this business for a reason, and it's really rewarding when you're able to sort of connect all the dots and provide those cool research nuggets in the right way to the right people at the right time. I think this slide is not for me.
Oh yeah, I think Tom, this was just kind of a kind of further reinforcing the point that online is certainly pervasive, and certainly has its place in Tom's very important vertical. So
it does. Just kind of it does. Yeah, and you know, when I look at this stat, you know, I've found other stats around here that sort of say a little bit more, a little bit less. overall, it's this idea of, look, regardless of what you think the percentage is for whatever your e-commerce figures are, it's going up, and it's going up on mobile in the future. And that's the main point here. So how do we actually respond to this? You know, you got to get in good with your digital teams and your design teams, and you got to make sure that your product guys are talking to your design guys to make sure that when they're offering stuff, not just the right stuff, but they're offering it in the right way. And in the hotel industry, we have a unique issue. Maybe it's not as unique as some of the industry you guys are in, but we compete not just with other hotel companies, but we also compete with aggregators, so OTAs, we call them, online travel agents. And the amount of bookings, of course, is enormous online. But then we also have another unique target segment, group of customers that are these online business corporate bookers that use their platforms. You know, we use Concur here. I don't know what you guys use there. And so how do we try to work with those sort of companies to provide the right experience as well? So it's complex, and it's an issue none of us can ignore, and trying to ignore it is just a huge mistake. So to get a little bit of detail about what I'm supposed to talk to you guys about today is what we did here at IHG, this sort of case study that I'm going to present to you. Overall, you know, our competition is extreme. We have those direct competitor hotels. We even compete with airline companies, online travel agents, traditional travel agents. And we have to constantly be on our toes then with delivering the right products in the right way with the right experience in mind. And a particular difficulty that we do have in our industry is that, in our company, is that we don't own a lot of our assets. So we're a heavily franchised company. So when we do want to offer something in the right way, we often don't have as great a control as we would love to have at our actual properties, at the hotels. So we have to focus a lot on providing the best experience and products that we can control. And one of the biggest mediums we have through that is the online booking experience. So when you go to IHG.com or when you go to HolidayInn.com and you want to book your actual hotel room, we can control that. So we have to make sure that when we do it, and we set it up for people, it's set up for success, and that it's a good experience, and we're offering the right products. So our goal here in this particular product that we're offering was to figure out how to offer travel-related services, so not just hotel rooms, travel-related services and products while people are booking their hotel room. I mean, this isn't anything new or groundbreaking. You know, I talked to the product guy yesterday, and I was like, by the way, I'm presenting this, you know, how much can I talk about and how much can I talk about? And, you know, he kind of laughed, and he said, well, it's not like we're doing anything groundbreaking here, but it is, you know, a little sensitive, so don't go into too many details about exactly what you're doing. But, I mean, I think you can probably figure out all we're trying to do is just offer travel-related services and products in the right way to the right people at the right time. After all, if you think about this sort of experience, online travel agents do this. So if you go to Orbitz or Expedia or Travelocity, they all do this. Airline companies are starting to do this, and other hotel companies are starting to do it as well. So we've got to make sure, in order to stay competitive, we're offering the right products, not only so our guests buy direct with us, so they go to IHG.com, because that encourages loyalty, and, you know, that makes us more money. But the trick also, of course, is to do it in a way online on our website that provides the right experience, not just because that makes us more money, but because we want to actually build brand equity. And one of the pitfalls a lot of companies might have in offering the right products, and, you know, they go out and they do real great work to say, this is the right product, I'm going to build my business case, I expect to sell this many and make this much profit and this much money. A lot of folks who are product managers, they often are not those same folks who are in tune with how customers want a product to be delivered to them, especially when it comes to an online experience. So if you don't do it in the right way, it's not only going to hurt your ability to sell, it's also going to have real severe impacts to your brand. So moving on, what the actual process here looks like for IHG when it comes to website development. And I want to talk about this a little bit because it's so important to us to make sure that we get the website right. And I'm sure if you're right now, you're still online, I'm going to IHG.com, like, I don't really like your website that much, or you say, hey, this isn't really the right experience for me. So we're developing. We're trying hard to make it right. And so the difficulty is not just in our company, but a lot of companies out there, probably some that you guys work with or work for, is that you're not just working with product owners. You're not just working with website teams. You're also working with design teams and design team vendors. And you're working with other stakeholders throughout the organization that also have a say in how the website is developed. So you're working with product teams. For us, we're working with our loyalty program folks. We're working with our reservation systems folks, so the back end, actual sort of guys who really get stuff done folks, and then digital and mobile and guest experience folks. So there's lots of different teams you have to involve. And when you're thinking of making a fundamental change to something for us, which is the booking flow, how we're going to direct people down this path of booking their hotel room. It's a fundamental change for our business, and it can have absolutely severe impact to our revenue. So we got to make sure that we do our homework and we get it right, and we do our iterative development process. So in a lot of organizations, what happens is, and this may happen here as well, I'm not going to say it does, but it may, is that, you know, there's no one approach. There's no one standard approach. When you look at this flow, it looks like it's optimal. You say, great, yeah, we're going to build our business case, and then we're going to go build some wireframes and test it, and then we're going to validate, and then we're going to do some more development and some more testing, and then have a soft launch, and then maybe we'll do some more development, and then we'll do a sort of soft launch, and then we'll go full market. That's great. That sounds really, really nice. I can't count on my fingers and toes how many times it actually happens like that. And the reason is because you have all these different people involved when you're making big changes. And this isn't anything you guys don't know. You know, I guess what I'm saying here is I'm struggling with these same things that you are. So how do I actually get around some of these hurdles? And one of the biggest hurdles, of course, is when you've got your product manager team, your product team, that says, I got my product. Now I need my design team to go build it for me, and I need them to get the experience right. Sometimes that design team, what I call, they go rogue, and they just start building. And it's no fault to them. They're designers. They have really great creativity, and they have a vision for how something should look. And they know what our competition does, and they know what they say is best in class out there, and they want it to be great, and they're great at that. But that doesn't always mean that they're appropriately testing what it is they're trying to build to make sure they're getting it right. And this is the job of the researchers or the insights guys. It's to step in and say, hold the phone here, guys. Before you go build out a bunch of stuff, we need to make sure that what we're doing is right. Because I don't want to get to A-B testing in a soft launch and find out that, oh, yeah, well, they like concept A better than they do concept B, but in reality, they hate both of them. Because we never tested them up front to find out and get that good context. So when we were, and that's sort of a plug to researchers, you know, researchers often are in the back room and we're the nerds, and, you know, people don't take us seriously all the time. And, you know, we're not supposed to really be in the spotlight all that time. We're supposed to be the coach on the sideline that helps people get through stuff. And more so, we're supposed to be those folks who see everything and know where to interject and say, hold up, guys. We need to stop, take a breath, and do the right thing before we press on. So what do we do here? So really what happened was, you know, we built out a great business case for this specific product offering on our booking flow. And what happened was, they were real excited to put this thing out there, to go into A/B testing, and they sort of forgot to test the wireframes first. So what happened was I got wind of this secondhand, and I stepped in and said, "Hold, guys, you gotta go test these wireframes first. Let's make sure that what we're doing is right." So they had one idea in mind, and I said, "Well, instead of having one idea, why don't you have a couple, and we'll go test a couple of them." So then we went down the path of testing these. I'll get into some more of the details on that later. So moving on to the next slide. That's sort of the overall process for website development and where Insights really needs to step in and play a role, not just from helping them develop that business case. You know, you do your standard quant and qual research there to figure out if the product's going to be good, how much money it can make us, but then moving on to interjecting and saying, before you go to deliver this thing, you guys need to think about what it's going to look like. So that's the overall process in terms of where Insights fits into our development process. Now, on this slide here, we're going to see are several challenges that we all encounter as researchers, or some of us as marketers, if you're just a regular old marketer on the line. But vendor or client side, these are challenges that you have heard, I bet, once or twice a day in your life. And, you know, the reason why I'm going to point out some of these challenges is, one, it's to say, yeah, you know, it's nice to hear somebody else have these problems too. But also, we've had some nice ways to try to overcome some of these particular challenges. So the first challenge is you're trying to help somebody out and they say, hey, I'm a research expert. Everybody thinks they're a research expert. If somebody wrote one questionnaire question, they all of a sudden are a research expert. If they presented a research deck done by a vendor, all of a sudden that person's a research expert. Everybody thinks they're a research expert. I mean, if that was the case, there wouldn't be a separate group of people who are just researchers. So we all know that this isn't true. Everybody's not a research expert. So how do you actually overcome this in a tactful way? Well, aside from, you know, building a lengthy relationship and doing something good for them that they've never seen before, and if you can tactfully tell them, hey, what you did, this isn't very good. You need to show them examples of what they're missing. So show them examples of what you've done in the past, whether that's at other companies or in the company you're in now, but you got to show them what the opportunity is. And for a lot of them, they may not have seen what real good consumer feedback looks like and how that applies to them specifically. So a lot of them will have seen slide after slide after slide of numbers, but they're not really sure of how to apply that. Or there may be another example where they might have seen all of these numbers that are, you know, they think is the word of God, but they've never actually talked to a consumer. They've never actually heard in a qualitative setting, here's how consumers actually feel about this. Here's why you're seeing those percentages move one way or another. So you got to show them what they're missing. The second challenge, of course, and this is going to be probably equally true for the client side and the vendor side, is I want it all, and I want it all right now, and I have nothing to spend. And this stinks. And you got to level set with them and say, sorry, you're going to have to spend something. This stuff isn't for free. And sorry, I can't get you the results this second, unless you're lucky enough to have done prior research, which you can sort of finagle the results and make some implications and say, you know, based on this other stuff, we think this is the right direction to move. So how do you overcome this? Is you've got to find some sort of what they talked about earlier is agile solutions in their budget. So you've got to be able to find a solution that gets them something quick. I'm not going to say dirty, because there are ways to find good quant and good qual feedback in a very timely manner. And actually, in this case study, I was shocked with how fast we were able to get results. And considering this was one of the first projects I worked on at IHG, it got me a lot of credit within the group, because they said, oh, Tom can deliver something that fast? That sort of set me up for failure in the future, because I can't do everything that fast all the time. But it was, you have to be able to be willing to explore different or unique options to get you the results you need within the time frame and within the budget. You can't always commit to doing, you know, fully blown out quantitative and qualitative focus groups or interviews. You have to be able to find something that fits within what they're doing, rather than try to apply our standard buckets of, you know, market research technique number one, number two, number three, here's how that works. That doesn't work anymore in our industry. You have to take what they need and totally adapt to it, because honestly, they don't care about researchers. They don't care about your time frame. They don't care about your budget. All they care about is themselves. And I hate to say it, but they're right, because they're the ones that are making money for the company. So we have to be able to work within their constraints. And this agile solutions is definitely a critical part of it. The third challenge, sorry, I gotta take a drink of water. The third challenge, and I hope you didn't hear that, we had a bunch of the Crown Plaza brand managers just screaming their heads off in the background. I don't know what they're doing. It's Crown Plaza. They're a fun bunch. The third challenge is they get a deck and they see these are great results, but I got no idea what to do with them. And this has been a market research or a researcher's problem in general for the last forever, is you see a giant deck and it's really a data dump or it's a bunch of quotes, and they had no idea how to actually apply those things. There's two things that we can do as market researchers to actually make ourselves more impactful. The first and most obvious is figure out what they really care about and make a better deck. Don't have a data dump. Actually get involved with their team, figure out what their goals are, and provide the right context in your deck and recommendations that are actionable. And I know this is a little tougher on the vendor side, because on the vendor side you say, well, I don't want to take that giant leap, and I don't want to make assumptions about your business. Well, you know what, on the client side, is we want vendors to do that. We want you to say, look, if this was you, what would you do? I can't guarantee I'm going to do it, but I need somebody to help me figure out what to do in an ideal world. And I'll figure out what's feasible and I'll apply it where I can. The other way we can overcome this challenge is to actually make our stakeholders part of the research process. So when you're saying, hey, I'm thinking about this method to help you out. How does this sound to you? What questions would you want to ask? And that makes them part of the process. It makes them feel invested, and it makes them feel like they want to turn their, what those results come, they see those as their results. And since they're their results, they want to put those into action. No longer are they the researcher's results, right? They can't say, well, Tom recommended I do this. No, it's not that anymore. Now it becomes, well, this was my research, so I need to make this decision based on this research. The fourth challenge, and this is particularly important across larger organizations, is, isn't somebody else working on this thing too? And we're going to say that as researchers, and we're going to say that if we're in other sales and marketing. So how many different people, for example, are working on our booking platform? Well, I just named off, I think, five different groups. So it's difficult to figure out who actually owns stuff and who can make stuff happen. So as an insights person, since you have that cross-functional scope, it is critical for you, above all other functions, to initiate that collaboration and making sure that they're going down the right path. Because you got to see yourself as an independent sort of consultant here. And otherwise, they're all going to want to take care of their own little thing rather than focusing on the big end goal. So that was my slide on, hey, so here's some issues that we all struggle with. And, you know, I know those are a pain, and I hope that you guys have found good ways to get past those as well as I have. And it's not easy. Those sort of things are not easy to overcome at all. But I think in this particular case, that second challenge that I want it all right now and I have no money to spend, that challenge is really where this particular case study can show off where it did well and how it really helped folks out, is this idea of the agile research and what GutCheck was able to provide me. So for this particular issue. So like I said, these guys developed a business case and we helped them with that business case, and then they sort of went dark, and before I knew it, they were ready for development, full-blown development. And that's when I got to step in and say, hold the phone here, guys. We need to step back, build out some wireframes, and test those wireframes to make sure we get the basics right before you really go down this path of development and spend hundreds of thousands of dollars trying to develop the actual new booking flow or the updated booking flow. So when I found this out, they wanted results in about 3 weeks. After I told them this, they said, hey, we need about 3 weeks before we actually have to commit to a specific development vendor for these website changes. And I said, well, 3 weeks, it's crazy. I can't get you something in 3 weeks for something like this, and it's a fundamental change to how we're going to be offering our products and services to our guests. I need some real good time to wrap my head around this and figure it out. So, of course, you know, my natural instinct as a researcher is to say, well, I want to do some qual exploration, and I want to do some quant to verify it, and if I need to, I'd like to set aside some time in the back end for additional follow-ups so I can get more context if I need it. But realistically, I had 3 weeks. In 3 weeks, you can barely put together one of those things. So I put out, of course, the RFP to a series of vendors and said, look, this is what I'm trying to do. And not one of them came back and said, yeah, I could do all this for you. I think I got one quote back that said, yeah, I can help you out with the qual stuff and the quant stuff. Unless we run it concurrently, you're on your own. And they weren't even verifying with me that they even could do it. It wasn't even going to be feasible for them. So a colleague of mine said, hey, you got to check out go check out GutCheck. And I'm not trying to sell GutCheck on you, because that's not the only vendor we use. We use plenty of vendors. It just depends on our need at that particular moment for that project. And so what happened was GutCheck came back and said, look, we can actually turn something around for you in, 1 to 2 weeks. And we can get you both quant and qual. And, they had their limitations in terms of how specific I can get my targeting for which people I want to talk to. But realistically, in trying to fit, and this goes back to that second issue I highlighted before, is as researchers, we need to be able to fit into what the marketers are trying to do rather than forcing them to fit into our constructs and our research methodologies. So I said, look, guys, this is great. So what I want to do is I want to get some quant and qual and get it back in a week or two. And they said, man, if you can do that for us and if you can do it within our budget, fantastic. Go make it happen. So I work with GutCheck to make this happen. And sure enough, we got it back. We got it on time. And it was great. And it provided us two essential things. One, it provided us the quant read that we needed on the wireframes to figure out which one worked best. And I'll go into some more details on that in a minute. And the second, and of course, a lot of people overlook this. Maybe researchers don't overlook it as much as other folks in the organization do. And that's the context. So people like it. Why do they like it? Right. That's important. It's not just important to know that for the sake of academia. It's not that sort of exercise. It actually does help for future development. If you know, yeah, they like this. 80% of people like this one as opposed to 20% like that one. So clearly we need to develop this one here. Well, yeah, why did they like that 80% one though? Were there only certain things in there that they liked and that's what was driving them? Because we can focus future development on those specific items. All right. So moving on, how did GutCheck fall in our, so you saw this process earlier, so where did GutCheck fall? So GutCheck fell into this wireframe test and iterate part right here. So I didn't have a lot of time here, like I said, just a couple of weeks to put something together for them before we moved on to the next phase, which was further testing and development, or development and then testing, and then a soft launch. But they were able to get me what I wanted when I needed in this process in just a 3 week time. And when you think about this whole process, I'm not using GutCheck later on in the development testing phase and in the soft launch and iteration and A/B testing phase. And that's because I was able to plan with a much greater, I had a lot more lead time. And once we got those wireframes set, which one we wanted to go with, They said, all right, Tom, great, we're going to go with this one. And after we do a first round of actual development, we're going to want to go test it again with a fully functioning page before we go start some A/B testing. And so for that fully functioning page, I was able to do a much more deep qualitative investigation there using a panel of people that I have at my disposal. And that's the method I use there. And when this comes up in the future again, and it will, and when somebody sneaks by me and they try to do something without validating it first, something that's essential, I'm going to go with either GutCheck or somebody that provides an agile solution like GutCheck does, so I can get that quant qual read in the time frame that I need, so long as, of course, it fits what I'm trying to do. Moving on, I think Matt has a question for you guys.
Yeah, you know, Tom, I think we're going to skip this. We've got about 12 minutes to the hour, and I think a lot of folks would probably like to see your case study. So why don't we jump to the case study slide here, and
sure.
We can go through that and then hopefully get to some questions and answers before the top of the hour.
Okay, great. So really what happened was we had an audience of two. We wanted to do quant and qual. So we had to do quant and qual because I'm not just going to run quant on something like this. I'm not just going to run qual on something like this. Quite frankly, the business needs quant numbers to justify what they're going to do. We all know that. Everybody wants to see percentage at the end of the day. But I need to be able to provide qual so I can say, here's why they did it, and here's how we can make improvements. So what we did was we talked to about 200 people in the quant portion of it, and we were able to target, not as specific as sometimes we'd like to target here, but I mean that's a trade-off of the agile solutions. But we were still able to target so we could say, yeah, these are general travelers. We had only six questions per concept, and we had three different concepts that we rotated by sequential monadic. And these were our success measures that we determined. So what's really, it was, which one do you like? Why don't you like it? And are they doing well on these things? Those were our key success measures. And then the qual, we had two groups, 40 people, and this was more of a panel approach where, you know, we put out the questions out there to them, and then they give us their feedback on why not they didn't like it. That way we could focus on improvement in the future. And I tell you what, it worked fantastic. And what happened was, if we go down to the key learning slide here, we had three different concepts we tested. Two of them actually performed very similarly in quantitative. So thank gosh, when we got those qualitative results back, we really figured out what was driving the appeal to those two different concepts, and why the third one we could just throw out. And, you know, having that context for the third one was crucial. That way we didn't make the mistake in iterative development with whichever the first two we went down. And after a lot of internal deliberation about what these findings meant and the feasibility of actually delivering them, we did narrow down to one of the concepts. And actually, we're still in development with this right now. We did actually incorporate some of the elements that people liked from the other concept. So those series of findings were absolutely critical. There's nothing else I really want to say on this slide that I think is critical, because I know we're running short on time, and I know there are questions, and Matt has some content he might want to back up on. But overall, on the next slide, here's my one big takeaway on the value of agile research to IHG is it's quick quant validation, because we're all looking for those numbers. But it's the contextual qual findings that make those quant numbers really actionable, and it can really provide that extra oomph of insight that we need in order to make the right decision and to iterate development appropriately for the next round. And I think that's all I got for you. I know Matt wants to get back to you.
Well, yeah, let's actually kind of move over to the questions now. You know, we've got about 8 minutes left here. Number one, I thought that was kind of a great overview, Tom. I really kind of like the challenges that you went through and how you go about addressing them. I like about how Agile can help you solve for some of that. And I also just like to get the additional context on the process you guys go through to build your e-commerce systems and really kind of all the challenges with all the stakeholder alignment you go through and how you incorporate the consumer throughout. So thank you for that. With that, I'm going to go into some Q&A here. Let's just take a quick look. And let me see here. One of the questions we had here was, why would you do the quant and qual simultaneously versus quant, then qual, or vice versa? Tom, do you want to take that question?
Yeah, absolutely. In an ideal world, I would love to, you know, start with qual and then go to quant because I want the qual to feed into the quant because I always know exactly what to ask in the quant, and that's the problem we struggle with as researchers. But like I said, we got to make sure that we're fitting our solution into what their needs are, and that's not always going to be ideal. A lot of us market researchers get hung up on, well, this is the exact right way to do things. And man, I get it. I understand. I want to do things the right way every single time. But the right way isn't always the way that works for our stakeholder needs. So that's why I combine those two into one, is I just needed the validation for the numbers with quant, and then I needed to provide that context with qual. And, you know, it worked. I think it worked pretty well. And, you know, if I had more time and more money, man, I would do it the way that you suggest, of course.
Excellent. There was just kind of this was meant to certainly to be kind of educational versus promoting GutCheck, but there was kind of a question about what GutCheck does. Does it do qual and quant, or were separate companies used? And just to kind of give you a brief overview of GutCheck, so GutCheck has a global agile market research solution, which is to say we conduct studies around the globe. It's agile in nature in that it's, like we talked about, fast and affordable. And we have both quantitative and qualitative techniques that we use. So in this case, we provided both quantitative and qualitative techniques to Tom and his group. We work primarily in the areas of new product development as well as communications development work. And so that's kind of where we apply the agile market research solutions that we have. Tom, maybe, maybe this is kind of another one, a question that came up is how do the benefits of Agile, tie back to other companies that aren't doing, e-commerce? And Tom, you've got a great background and kind of different roles. Do you want to kind of, extend how you think about Agile in other contexts outside of e-commerce?
Sure. I mean, it's the same principle application no matter what business you're in. So when I was at UPS, I wish that we were thinking a little more outside the box in terms of our research methodologies than I am thinking about now. And that's probably just experience, and it's probably also technology, and it's also the vendors that are help setting me straight sometimes when I need them to interject and say, hey, Tom, have you tried this out before? So at UPS, it was, you know, how quickly do we get stuff from point A to point B? That's really it, you know, and how do we provide the right products and services that enable that? And so UPS, they do a lot of product development. You might not know about it because as a consumer, you don't see those things happening in the background. All you care about is getting your package. But in doing that product development, the amount of time it would take to validate those products and going through the iterative product development cycle. So here's an actual physical product that's going to enable us to get something to you faster. Do I need consumer feedback on some of those things? Most of them, no. On some of them, though, I might. And in that case, I'm still going to want feedback from people to find out if that's what goes out. So, for example, if you're in the CPG industry and you want to change packaging and you want to hurry up and test something out on the shelf, but you don't want to put something on the shelf that's just awful and you got a limited time frame to do it, an agile solution here is perfect for you. You're going to get the quant qual feedback. You're going to get it quickly. You're going to do it for not much money. And you're going to be able to go straight to your shelf testing, which CPG folks love to do because they're quick, they're super quick, and And it's a perfect solution for that sort of stuff as well.
Excellent. Thanks, Tom. Just kind of one last quick question somebody had, and then I think we'll kind of wrap it up. We've been hearing this buzz on our end, and I think that's telling us our time is about to end. But the question is, how do we recruit so quickly here at GutCheck? Do we pull from an internal panel? The answer is no, we don't pull from an internal panel. One of the innovations that we created here at GutCheck was the ability to technically and from a process perspective integrate with panel companies that are out there. So we've gone through and partnered with what we think are the top panel companies out there, depending on the regions that we want to be in and also the type of audiences that we're going after. We partnered with them and then integrated with them both technically and from a process perspective, and that allows us to have the speed that we do. With that, I am going to wrap it up, give you all a minute back in your day. First of all, I want to thank Tom for being so gracious with his time and educating us today on IHG, his work there, and what they're doing in e-commerce development. And then thank you, all of you, for spending some time with us today, and I hope you gained some valuable learnings. Have a great day.
Thank you, Matt, and I appreciate your time as well. And so for our audience here today, I'd like just to let you know that this does conclude our presentation today. Thank you for joining us. You will be receiving an email with an alert that will let you get to the on-demand status of today's event, which I think is important because we want to make sure that we get to all the questions and present all of the information that we have, specifically when we got a value proposition that is, you know, literally saving a lot of time and money on research projects. So there's a lot of value here. So on behalf of our guest, IHG's Tom Noggle and GutCheck's Matt Warta, as well as the entire team at GutCheck and Survey Magazine, my name is John Lehman, and we wish you a great afternoon. Thank you for attending today.